The schedule for the conference has been handed out. It involves Professor Engelsma speaking twice this morning, and then between those two speeches, we'll have a morning coffee break. And then after the second will be our noon lunch. In the afternoon, Reverend Ronald Hanko will speak, and after the afternoon break, Reverend James Lanning will give his presentation. The first speech this morning is by Professor Engelsma, well known enough to all of us that I will not give any further introduction, who will speak on Bavink, the man and his theology.
Thank you, Reverend Kuiper. I am delighted to be in your midst today for several reasons. And one is simply that the occasion of my presence here is the assembly of classes west of the Protestant Reformed churches. For 25 years, from 1963, when I was ordained into the ministry in the Protestant Reformed churches, through the spring assembly of 1988, I attended every meeting of classes west, regular and special, with one exception. And during those years, I came to have great affection for classes west. I did not always enjoy the meetings, and the reason for that was that the meetings were by no means always enjoyable. But I did come to esteem the classes highly as an assembly of Jesus Christ that was wholeheartedly committed to doctrinal truth and to church political righteousness, come what may. Since the fall of 1988, I have never again had the opportunity to attend a meeting of classes west, and the fact that I am able to do that now or tomorrow is one reason for my delight. The second reason for my gladness to be among you is also personal, and I beg your indulgence in my indicating this personal reason for being with you today and tomorrow. I mentioned that I attended every meeting of Classes West with one exception. That one exception was the spring meeting in 1972, when I was still pastor of the congregation in Loveland, Colorado. On March 3, 1972, a lovely daughter was born to Ruth and me, and because of that, I sent my regrets and an alternate to the meeting of Classes West. But as a result of this birth date, the first week in March, I was away from home, usually on the birthday of this daughter. And she has reproached me for this, and I have detected some resentment on her part over against Classes West for keeping me away from home on her birthday, and so I take this opportunity given to me in the providence of God to extend to her in the presence of the delegates of Classes West a happy birthday, Jennifer. The third reason for my delight is the main one, no doubt, and that is the opportunity that I have to speak to you about the important Dutch Reformed theologian Herman Bavink. With the publication of Herman Bavink's Reformed Dogmatics in English for the first time by the Dutch Reformed Translation Society, and the fourth and last volume of the Reformed Dogmatics appeared a few years ago in 2008, with the publication of those dogmatics in English for the first time, there has occurred a kind of Bavink Renaissance in North America. This would be a good thing if the Reformed churches would pay attention to the sound and solid Reformed doctrines in the four volumes of the Reformed Dogmatics, and if the churches would allow these sound doctrines to critique and correct the teachings of these churches. What has happened, however, for the most part, is that the sound doctrines in the Reformed Dogmatics have either been largely ignored or deliberately misrepresented, particularly Bavink's doctrine of the covenant, which we shall see Bavink considered to be an extraordinarily important doctrine. Also, the churches and the theologians have seized upon erroneous doctrines in the Reformed dogmatics, even though those erroneous teachings do not occupy a prominent position in the Reformed dogmatics, have emphasized these false teachings, particularly the teaching of a common grace of God. And I note here that you will not find the phrase common grace either in the chapter titles or in the subheadings of the Reformed dogmatics. Similarly, the Bavink conferences that have been held, at least the prominent conferences, have completely ignored the Reformed doctrines of Bavink, as set forth in the Reformed dogmatics, and have devoted themselves to Bavink's views on ecumenicity, psychology, and especially culture. This was true of the Bavink conference sponsored by Princeton Seminary a few years ago. And this was also the case with the 2 or 3 day Bavink conference sponsored shortly after the publication in English of the Reformed dogmatics by Calvin Seminary and by the Dutch Reformed Translation Society. At that conference, not one single speech had to do with the Reformed doctrine or with Reformed doctrines as a whole. All of the speeches were about church union and about cultural endeavors. That was ironic in view of the fact that the Dutch Reformed Translation Society had spent about $150,000 translating and publishing the Reformed dogmatics, but that is what took place. Bavink himself is partly responsible for this neglect of his dogmatics. Alongside of his dogmatical work was always a powerful cultural urge. Toward the end of his life, this became virtually his sole concern. But the explanation of the churches and theologians ignoring of Bavink's theology for his cultural writings is also that these churches and theologians have little, if any, interest in the sound and solid Reformed doctrines that are found in Bavink's magnum opus. They are rather obsessed with culture and with ecumenicity. This conference may very well have the distinction that it will be the first to be devoted not only chiefly, but also exclusively to the Reformed doctrines in the Reformed dogmatics, and thus to the real significance of the monumental Reformed dogmatics, if not of Bavink himself. At this conference, we are concerned with the theology of Bavink. And our concern is not merely academic. Rather, we want to consider the glorious truths of the Reformed faith as they are confessed, explained, defended, and developed in Bavink. Where they are present to spoil Reformed theology, we want to expose and reject the weaknesses and errors in the Reformed dogmatics. And our ultimate goal is to maintain and develop further the sound Reformed doctrines that Bavink teaches in the 4 volumes of his dogmatics. In this first speech at our Bavink conference concerning Bavink the man and the theology of the Reformed dogmatics, I am to introduce both The Man and His Theology. I do not intend simply to tell you the outstanding features of Bavink's life and personality, and then briefly go on to outline his theology. But I want to relate the man and his theology, the personal character of the man and his dogmatics, the life of the man and the work of the man. There is such a connection between every great theologian and his theology. The obvious example with which all of us are familiar is Martin Luther. His personal misery over the guilt of his sin and his personal courage in proclaiming and defending the truth of the gospel, God used in the work that he had for Luther. There is definitely such a relation also between the man Bavink and his dogmatics. This relation concerns Bavink's strengths, but this concern also has to do with Bavink's weaknesses. I have arranged the speech as follows. First, I will treat the important aspects of Bavink's life and ministry. Next, I will set forth what I judge to be outstanding strengths of his doctrine or theology. And then finally, I will expose some prominent weaknesses of his theology, concluding with a very brief application of what I have said about the man and his theology to Protestant Reformed office bearers and to the Protestant Reformed churches. You should know at the outset that for my understanding of Bavink the man, I have relied especially upon three important biographies and studies of Bavink in the Dutch language. One is Dr. Herman Bavink by Valentin Hepp. The second is Herman Bavink, Als Dogmaticus, Herman Bavink as a Dogmatician, by R.H. Bremer, that's more recent, a 1961 publication. And third, Bremer's work, Bavink en zijn tijdgenoten, that is, Bavink and his contemporaries. I have also read and will make some use of the only full biography of Bavink in the English language, Herman Bavink by Ron Gleason. But in my judgment, the study of Bavink by Ron Gleason, the only study available in English, is a poor work. It is a poor work because it is poorly written. There are many typos and many mistaken uses of words. It is a poor work also because it is avowedly anti-Abraham Kuyper and pro-liberated. And besides that, it suffers also from being factually inaccurate. Unfortunately, therefore, the good works on Bavink are only to be found today yet in the Dutch language. In preparing this lecture, and now in giving it, I am keeping before my mind the warning of an event in the life of Bavink. Hepp relates that at the public ceremony of Bavink's installation of professor of theology in the seminary in Kampen, at which installation the professor would give a learned and fitting address, the professor who preceded Bavink in the program, who was also installed on that occasion, delivered himself of an address that lasted longer than 3 hours. And the environment was a very cold church building. Bavink became so angry at the length of the speech of the man who preceded him on the podium that he stormed angrily out of the meeting, creating a scene. He indicated that he refused to give his own address and only the pleas of his aged father and of others at the meeting changed his mind. But Bavink indicated his disgust with the length of the preceding address by reading his speech as fast as possible and reading it without any inflection whatsoever. Now that's a warning to me. Bavink was notoriously ironic or peace-loving, and if an overlong speech could drive him to such extremes, what might an overlong speech do to my colleagues here, not all of whom are necessarily as ironic or peace-loving as Bavink? I will surely keep this speech under 3 hours. First of all, I want to notice with you important aspects of Bavink's life and work. Hermann Bavink was the son of the Secession. The Secession was the wonderful reformation of the Reformed Church in the Netherlands that began in 1834 in Ulrum, Groningen, with the preaching and then the deposition of the minister, Hendrik de Kock. Bavink himself expressed on his departure from Kampen for Amsterdam in 1903 that he was and intended to be a faithful son of that reformation of the church. He said in Dutch on that occasion, "I am a child of the separation or secession, and that I hope to remain." Bavink was born in 1854, 20 years after the secession began, and the year that the churches of the secession, which called themselves originally the Christian Separated Reformed Churches, opened their seminary in Kampen, where Bavink would teach for many years. When I say that Bavink was a son of the secession, I'm saying something that accounts for much that is sound in Bavink's theology, particularly his doctrine of the covenant of grace in relation to God's eternal decree of election, as well as accounting for the godliness and warmth of Bavink's dogmatical work, the Reformed Dogmatics. Bavink's father, John, was a pious, humble man who had been converted in 1840 by a disciple of Hendrik de Kock, a minister by the name of Sundag. And that man, by whose instrumentality Bavink's father was converted, that man had been imprisoned some 30 times for his proclamation and defense of the gospel recovered by the secession. Bavink's father was himself a minister in the secession churches. In fact, the first of the secession ministers to receive any kind of a formal training by other ministers. When Bavink was installed as professor in the secession seminary in Kampen in January of 1883, the faculty included Helenius de Kock, Anthony Brummelkamp, and Simon van Velzen. The first was the son of the founder of the secession churches, and the latter two, Brummelkamp and van Velzen, were famous fathers of the secession of 1834. Bavink, therefore, was born and reared at the very heart of the then still vibrant and powerful tradition of the secession. The theology and spirit of the secession of 1834 were the air that Hermann Bavink breathed. By the spirit of the secession, I mean its piety or godliness. its wholehearted commitment to the Reformed confessions and to the teaching of John Calvin, and the repudiation of theological modernism by the secession. This son of the secession, and that is who Herman Bavink was spiritually, nevertheless was attracted to the world. He was not attracted to the world morally, as though he found the godless life of the world pleasing, much less lived immorally himself, for Herman Bavink was a pious man, and he wrote a treatise excoriating the worldly life of his day, Hedendaagse Moraal, the present day morality. Hep informs us that in fact it was, quote, a thorn in his eye, end quote, that certain members of the secession churches lived careless, wicked lives in contradiction to their confession. But when I say that Bavink was attracted to the world, I mean that he was attracted to the world's learning, the wisdom of educated thinkers, the scientific theories of his day, including Darwin's theory of evolution, and even in certain respects, the unbelieving theological wisdom of modernist theologians. Bavink was impressed by that worldly thinking. Bavink thought that the Reformed faith can be accommodated to that learned worldly thinking. And he supposed that Reformed doctrines would influence the world's thinking and learning. And this is why some scholars have spoken of two Bavinks, two different Bavinks. One was the son of the secession, that pious, spiritually holy man who loved the teachings of the Reformed creeds and of John Calvin, and in contrast, the Bavink who was attracted to the thinking of the world. Bavink's biographer, Valentin Hepp, denies that it is accurate to refer to Bavink as two Bavinks, but he does recognize what he calls the, quote, duality, end quote, in Bavink. However one may describe this duality in Bavink's soul, the conflict between the thinking of the son of the secession and the thinking that found the wisdom of the world both true and attractive had a harmful effect on Bavink's theology, as we will see. That which Bavink found appealing in the world's thinking, he explained by his own and Abraham Kuyper's doctrine of common grace. Bavink showed this attraction to the world's wisdom and acted on it already early in his life as a young man. When he was preparing for the ministry in the secession churches, after only 1 year of training in the seminary of the secession churches in Kumpen, Bavink decided to complete his seminary training in the thoroughly modernist seminary of the State Reformed Church, from which his own churches had seceded some 40 years earlier. That was at Leiden in the Netherlands. The professors at the Leiden Seminary were unbelievers, and all of the Netherlands knew this. The professors at that seminary denied the bodily resurrection of Jesus, despised the Calvinistic doctrines of salvation by sovereign grace, which were dear to the heart of the secession churches. And those professors were notorious higher critics of Holy Scripture. They were Scholten, Kunin, Rauenhoff, and others. Bavink's determination to finish his seminary training at that seminary was as though an aspirant to the ministry in the Protestant Reformed churches would reject the Protestant Reformed seminary, not even for Calvin Theological Seminary, but for the University of Chicago Divinity School and the teachings of the unbeliever Paul Tillich. Why he chose Leiden, Bavink himself told us. He judged that the theological instruction at the small secession seminary was inferior and unsatisfactory, and it did leave something to be desired, especially in the area of dogmatics. And then Bavink added, and I quote now, "He cherished a strong desire to further my study in Leiden and to learn the modernist theology at first hand," end of quote. The Christian Reformed translator of Bavink's own summary, one volume summary of his four volumes of the Reformed dogmatics, and that one volume is called in Dutch Magnalia Dei, the wonderful works of God. I say this, the Christian Reformed translator of that one volume summary of the Reformed dogmatics, in English it has the title Our Reasonable Faith, extols the benefits of Bavink's theological education at Leiden. Bavink himself, however, spoke more soberly about the effects of that modernist training at Leiden. This is what Bavink himself noted as to the effects of his seminary training at Leiden. Quote, "Leiden has often made me very poor and has deprived me of much that I now, in a later time, have learned to appreciate as indispensable for my own spiritual life, especially when I must make sermons," end of quote. Bavink added that Leiden's effect on its students, and that included Bavink himself, was that, quote, "their childlike trust in the word of the apostles," that scripture, "is shaken," end of quote. This was the effect of his Leiden training on Bavink himself. The effect was that he suffered from serious doubt concerning the inspiration of scripture. During his pastorate at Franeker, with which he began his ministry, he confided to a friend that he struggled with doubt concerning scripture. "Outwardly," he said, "I must show myself to be the confident dominie. Inwardly, I am always wrestling with doubt about Holy Scripture." All his ministry long, he struggled with what Hep calls a, quote, "duality in his spiritual existence with regard to Scripture," end of quote. That doubt concerning Scripture did not diminish as his ministry continued, but rather became stronger in his old age. In the last part of his ministry, when he was professor of theology at the Free University of Amsterdam, he well nigh succumbed to sheer skepticism, that is, the conviction of the relativity of all knowledge, including the relativity of theological knowledge. This severe struggle that Bavink endured all his ministry affected his personality. All his biographers note that toward the end of his life, he became a very gloomy and somber man. This powerful doubt concerning Scripture in his soul, explains why in none of his writings during the last 10 years of his ministry did he explain Scripture or even work with the Bible. As we will see, this doubt about inspiration found its way into Bavink's own treatment of the doctrine of Scripture in the Reformed dogmatics, and thus found its way into the Reformed churches in the Netherlands, particularly the writings of Gerrit C. Berkouwer, and because of the influence of the Dutch Reformed churches, this doubt concerning Scripture has also found its way into Reformed churches in North America that have a name for orthodoxy. Bavink spent 6 years at the Leiden Seminary from 1874 to 1880, obtaining his doctorate, and he was the first secession minister to earn a doctorate in 1880. During those years, he became especially close to the Old Testament professor, Abraham Kuenen. Abraham Kuenen was a higher critic of Scripture. That is, he believed that the Bible was nothing more than another human book subject to all of the criticism that anyone might give to any other human book. And significantly, Bavink had a picture of Abraham Kuenen hanging in his study throughout his ministry. During those 6 years, Bavink became close friends with a fellow student with the odd name of Snouk Hurgronje. Even though Snouk was a thoroughgoing modernist, that means unbeliever, Bavink kept up a close friendship with the man as long as he lived. And it says something not only about Bavink's ability, but also regarding his decided indecisiveness regarding modernism, that some 9 years after he graduated from Leiden with a doctorate, the Board of Trustees of the Leiden Seminary considered Bavink as a candidate for a professorship in the Leiden Seminary to replace the unbeliever Rauenhoff. No account of Bavink's training at Leiden would be complete that omits the incident at his examination by the secession churches before Bavink could be accepted as a candidate for the ministry in the Christian separated Reformed churches. The secession churches allowed him to study for the ministry at the Leiden Seminary, but before he could be accepted into the secession churches as a minister, he had to undergo an examination by the curatorium, or we would say the theological school committee of the secession churches. An old secession preacher whose name lives in honor for his deed on that occasion, J.F. Bulens van Varseveld, required that Bavink preach a sermon on the first part of Matthew 15, verse 14. Matthew 15, verse 14 reads this way, "Let them alone, they be blind leaders of the blind." One of the requirements for examination into the secession churches was that Bavink preach a sermon on a selected text, and this old secession preacher deliberately picked that text, "Let them alone, they be blind leaders," recognizing full well that Bulens had Bavink's Leiden professors in view. Bavink was furious over the selection of his text. At first, he refused to carry out his duty of preaching a sermon on that text. Again, his father and his friends got him to change his mind. But Bavink's opening words in his sermon were these, "Why this text has been assigned exactly to me is not difficult to figure out. And then he went on to note that in assigning the portion of the text that he must preach on, omitted were the words of the blind, which would of course have meant that Bavink himself was a blind disciple of these blind leaders. The explanation of Bavink's seeking theological education at Leiden is what the Germans call Kulturtrieb, that is, the strong desire for culture, for worldly culture. This was one of the most powerful influences upon Bavink all his life. Bavink's active ministry, first in the Christian separated Reformed churches until 1982, when those churches merged with Kuyper's Doleantse churches, and therefore thereafter in the Reformed churches in the Netherlands, the GKN, until his death in 1921, I say Bavink's active ministry consisted of one brief pastorate and then of two long stints in two seminaries. First, the theological school of the secession churches, and then the Free University of Amsterdam. Bavink began his ministry with a very brief pastorate of less than 2 years in Franeker in the illustrious province of Friesland. By all accounts, Bavink was a good preacher, although he did not care much for the pastoral side of the ministry. He did not care much for teaching catechism to the little children, by his own admission. There's something noteworthy about Bavink's brief pastorate in Franeker, in addition to its brevity and in addition to his struggle with doubt concerning the inspiration of Scripture. What is significant about his brief pastorate is that he succeeded, not directly, but at second hand, the pastorate of a secession minister by the name of K.J. Peters, P-I-E-T-E-R-S. Peters had been the pastor of that congregation shortly before Bavink accepted the call to that congregation. Now, Peters was the man who, with his colleague J.R. Croylan, introduced into the churches of the secession the doctrine of a conditional covenant with all the baptized children alike. And that doctrine included the denial of any connection between the covenant and election. The teaching of Peters and Croylan, and Peters was the predecessor of Bavink in that church in Franeker, caused a storm of controversy in that congregation and also in the entire denomination of the secession churches. Peters and Croylan had written a little book called De Kinderdoop, that is, The Baptism of Infants. They wrote that book in 1861. Bavink came to that church in 1883, so not that long afterwards. In addition, the heretic was a drunk. Peters was a drunk. Time and time again, he had to be disciplined by his consistory. And time again, he fell into public drunkenness in the church and in the community. On one occasion, he admitted to his elders that he made, and I quote now the Dutch, an al te vrij gebruik van spiritus. That is, he admitted to his elders, I make an all too free use of spirits. Because the elders in those days got to the very bottom of matters, we even know the brand of spirits with which Reverend Peters made all too free a use. We are told that it was skidamer. Finally, the consistory deposed him, whereupon he split the church, carried on an independent ministry for a while, and then joined with his remnant of the congregation, a church denomination that was not at all reformed. Significantly, when Bavink arrived in that congregation at Franeker, he criticized Peters for not preaching according to the confessions and for being, in fact, in disagreement with the creeds. This was Bavink's judgment on the covenant doctrine of Peters and Croyland, and therefore on the covenant doctrine of the liberated Reformed churches and of the Federal Vision movement today. When Bavink came to write that section of his dogmatics that deals with the relation of the covenant and election, he was very familiar with the doctrine of Peters and Croyland and deliberately rejected that doctrine. Bavink taught that election governs the covenant, particularly regarding the baptized children of godly parents. In 1882, the Synod of the Secession Churches appointed Bavink to be professor at the theological school in Compton. I think I mentioned earlier that he was ordained into the ministry in 1883. That was mistaken. He was ordained as a minister upon his graduation from Leiden in 1880. He stayed in his first pastorate for a little less than 2 years, and then in 1882, the Synod of the Secession Churches appointed him to be professor of theology at the seminary in Compton. Bavink was only 28 years old when he was appointed to the seminary in Compton. There he taught mainly dogmatics for almost 20 years until 1902. During those years, he was colleague for a while with those illustrious men of the secession, Helenius de Cook, Simon van Velzen, and Anthony Brummelkamp. During those years, too, Bavink wrote his great work, The Four Volumes of the Reformed Dogmatics. The final volume appeared in Dutch, of course, in 1901. During that time, the churches of the secession, the Afscheiding in Dutch, united with the churches that were under the leadership of Abraham Kuyper, the churches that were known as the doleancy, or grieving churches, in 1886. At first, Bavink was opposed to that union, and mainly because of what he called, quote, the supremacy of Dr. Kuyper, end of quote. But in time, he became an enthusiastic promoter of the union and was very influential in bringing about the union of the two denominations into what took the name of the Reformed churches in the Netherlands. Three times while he was at Compton, Bavink was appointed to the prestigious position of professor of theology at the Free University of Amsterdam. Abraham Kuyper and the other leaders at the Free University recognized Bavink's theological gifts and desired him to serve on the faculty. Twice he turned that appointment down, and the third time he accepted it. Also during his years at Compton, Bavink married Johanna Adriana Skippers in 1891 when he was a mature 37 and his wife a young 23. They had one child, a daughter. In 1902, Bavink accepted the appointment to teach dogmatics at the Free University, replacing Abraham Kuyper himself, who had gone on to the lower and lesser position of Prime Minister of the Netherlands. Bavink was 48 when he was appointed to the faculty at the Free and accepted that appointment. And there, strangely, Bavink lost his zeal for theology, except for teaching his courses. He sold his theological library because, as he said, "I will not be needing these books anymore." After 1911, he lived to until 1921. After 1911, he never wrote another theological book, although during that time he wrote much in other fields, especially psychology and education. Those years also marked a distinct, noticeable change in Bavink's spiritual and psychological attitude. He became gloomy, somber. He appeared to the people as depressed. He seemed to be a soul that was tormented. Hep, his earliest biographer, who knew Bavink personally and well, describes his teacher and friend this way, quote, "He was tormented with problems," end of quote. According to Hep, the problems were three: the future of European society. Those were the days of World War I. Bavink was oppressed with torment concerning the future. He was depressed because of the scripture problem, and he was depressed because of the culture problem. He died in 1921 at the age of 67. Shortly before his death, knowing he was lying on his deathbed, he said this, quote, "Now my scholarship avails me nothing, nor can my dogmatics. It is only my faith can save me," end of quote. Before we look briefly at Bavink's theology, I offer these comments concerning various aspects of Bavink's life. First, in the providence of God, specifically with regard to the maintenance and development of the truth, Bavink stood in the mainstream of the Protestant and Reformed tradition. He stood in the stream of the Netherlands of Dort, in the stream of the glorious secession of 1834, in the stream of the doctrinal orthodoxy of Abraham Kuyper, to say nothing of other notable Reformed theologians in the Netherlands between Dort and the secession, for example, Vutzius and Witsius. Second, I note about Bavink that he was a diligent, well-read, indeed brilliant Reformed theologian. Especially during his years at Kampen, he read astoundingly widely. He thought deeply, and he wrote industriously. Apart from all of his other books, and there are a number of other fine works, particularly a little work on the certainty of faith, the four volumes of the Reformed dogmatics are a monumental achievement. Bavink was simply a theologian's theologian. Third, I note about him in general that he links the Protestant Reformed churches with the theology of the secession, especially the secession's covenant doctrine, as well as with all that is good in the Reformed tradition going back to Calvin. Bavink links the Protestant Reformed churches with that tradition, both with regard to the content of Reformed theology and with regard to the time in which he lived. With regard to time, Bavink, who died only 3 years before the Christian Reformed Church expelled Herman Hoeksema in 1924, was contemporary with most of the fathers of the secession. With regard to the content of Reformed theology, in many important doctrines, the Protestant Reformed churches confess and preach the Reformed faith as systematized and presented by Herman Bavink. If Herman Hoeksema was not heavily influenced by Herman Bavink, as I am convinced that he was, then Herman Hoeksema certainly carried on, in the main, the tradition of the development of Reformed truth as found in Bavink's Reformed dogmatics. With that, I turn briefly to an overview of the strength and worth of the theology of Herman Bavink. The Reformed Dogmatics of Herman Bavink, the four volumes of the Reformed Dogmatics, is a worthy, indeed praiseworthy, work of Reformed theology, setting forth the doctrines of the Reformed faith in a thorough, comprehensive, systematic, and generally sound way. The Reformed Dogmatics of Bavink are monumental. These are some of the outstanding strengths of the Reformed dogmatics. They present, in the systematic form of a carefully worked out dogmatics, the wealth of the Reformed faith as it was confessed and developed from Calvin to the beginning of the 20th century, with special attention to the development of the Reformed faith in the Netherlands, which was, of course, from the Synod of Dordogne, the mainstream of the Reformed tradition at that time. Second, the Reformed dogmatics are based on and in harmony with the Reformed creeds. I am not claiming that the Reformed dogmatics never deviate from the creeds. They do, and in some respects, grievously. But I am saying that Bavink labored consciously and with determination in the conviction that the Reformed creeds embody the truth of Scripture and that they are authoritative for Reformed theology. This accounts, of course, for the general soundness and the real worth of the Reformed dogmatic. Third, it is a strength of the Reformed dogmatics that their scope is vast, helpfully vast. Here, Bavink's spirit-given brilliance as a theologian and spirit-worked diligence at his dogmatical labors are evident. The Reformed dogmatics gives a virtually complete history of dogma and a sketch of church history. The Reformed dogmatics take into account all along the way the fathers of the early church and the ecumenical creeds. The Reformed dogmatics interacts with just about every theological institution or denomination. The Greek Orthodox Church, the Roman Catholic Church, the Church of the Middle Ages, the Lutheran Church, and the cults. And of course, the Reformed dogmatics interacts with the teaching of the Reformers, not only Calvin, but also Luther, Bucer, Vermigli, and a host of others. In addition, the Reformed dogmatics analyze philosophers who have posed a threat to the church down the ages, Plato, Kant, and others. There is hardly a heretic who escapes exposure from Montanus, Arius, and Pelagius to Pigius, Arminius, and Schleiermacher. Always Bavink lays bare in a few clear sentences the fundamental error and its contradiction of the truth. There is a special emphasis on the heretics and heresies that were threatening the Reformed churches in Bavink's own time. Modernism, mediating theology, Methodism, we would say fundamentalism and revivalism, and ethical theology. Fourth, Bavink wrote the Reformed dogmatics convinced that the truths of Holy Scripture, the content of Reformed dogmatics, the truths of Holy Scripture are non-contradictory. The reason, according to Bavink, is that there is no contradiction in the mind of God. This is what Bavink himself says about this matter in his prolegomena, his introduction. Quote, "There is no conflict in God. God's thoughts cannot be opposed to one another. They are necessarily an organic unity. The imperative task of the theologian is to think God's thoughts after him, to trace their unity and set it forth in a work of theology." End of quote. Again, I'm not saying that there are in fact no contradictions in the content of the Reformed dogmatics. There are contradictions. Those are errors, but I am saying that Bavink was not a paradoxical theologian. He was not a Dutch Karl Barth. This conviction about the non-contradictory nature of the content of the Bible safeguarded Bavink's confession of salvation by sovereign grace in many crucially important places in the Reformed dogmatics. Now I become specific concerning the strengths and worth of the Reformed dogmatics. The strength and worth of those dogmatics include the following. First, the Reformed dogmatics are biblical. Throughout, Bavink derives the doctrines from Scripture and invariably mentions the Scriptures from which he derives his doctrine and on the basis of which he teaches them. This benefits the Reformed dogmatics, and greatly so, in several ways. First, in general now, the Reformed dogmatics are orthodox. And second, they are fresh and lively, as not all dogmatics are fresh and lively. Bavink contends for such a dogmatics in the prolegomena. Quote, "Dogmatic theology is not a dull and arid science," end quote. And a third benefit of Bavink's deriving all of the doctrines out of Scripture is that this resulted in some important development of dogma. Another strength of the Reformed dogmatics, in close connection with its avowed biblical character, is that the Reformed dogmatics are God-centered. Again, Bavink set himself this task with the whole of the massive Reformed dogmatics from the very outset. All of it, he contended, must be knowledge of God in systematic form. I quote him again, "Theology is a science about God, not about religion or about faith. The aim of theology is nothing other than that the rational creature know God and knowing him, glorify him." End of quote. The Reformed dogmatics, therefore, is, in Bavink's own words, quote, "a doxology to all God's virtues and perfections, a hymn of adoration and thanksgiving," end of quote. And I may note here that this is one reason why the layman or woman can read the Reformed dogmatics, can understand them, and will certainly read them or read in them with profit. Because the Reformed dogmatics of Bavink are God-centered, they are also warm and practical. Bavink wove ethics, Christian behavior, into the dogmatics. No doubt his heritage as a son of the secession contributes to the piety, the godliness of the presentation of Reformed doctrine in the Reformed dogmatics. Bavink was no pietist. He condemned the advocacy of doubt concerning salvation on the part of the Puritans and their spiritual descendants in the movement in the Netherlands called the Nadere Reformatie, the Nearer Reformation or Further Reformation. He condemned that pietism with its advocacy of doubt concerning salvation, especially in his little book, The Certainty of Faith. But Bavink was pious, as every Reformed Christian ought to be pious, and he deliberately allowed the godliness or piety of Reformed doctrine to come out in the Reformed dogmatics, as is not always done. Then third, it is a strength of the Reformed dogmatics that it affirms, explains, and defends the sovereignty of the grace of God in Jesus Christ in salvation. From beginning, that's predestination in the eternal counsel of God, to the end, that's God's preservation of his saints until the day of Jesus Christ. Now this is the heart of the gospel, and it also is the heart of Reformed dogmatics. Bavink taught God's sovereignty, both in election and reprobation, affirming unconditional predestination against all forms of conditionality, including an explicit condemnation of Arminianism and Amaraldianism. Amaraldianism being a subtle form of Arminianism, which stresses the conditionality of salvation. Indeed, in a 60-page treatment of the divine counsel of God, Bavink contended for the truth that, quote, all the decrees of God are based on his absolute sovereignty, end quote. Charging that the doctrine of universal atonement separates Christ from election and the covenant, Bavink affirms, in the face of all the arguments raised against it, including the favorite texts of the defenders of universal atonement, definite, limited atonement. I quote him, "It was God's will and intent that Christ make his sacrifice only for the sins of those whom the Father had given him," end of quote. And then again, quote, "the acquisition and application of salvation are inseparably connected. As the intercession of Christ is particular, so also is the sacrifice," end of quote. The work of salvation by the Holy Spirit, which in Bavink's theology begins with the efficacious internal call, is likewise, quote, "solely a gift of grace," end quote. This grace is, quote, "efficacious and irresistible," end of quote. In a beautiful, heartwarming, and God-glorifying, if brief section, Bavink confesses the perseverance of saints, not as, quote, "the activity of the human person, but a gift from God," end quote. Perseverance is rooted in election, founded on the atonement, the sure effect of almighty grace, and due ultimately to the faithfulness of God in the covenant of grace. All of this work of salvation, from the internal call to preservation for Bavink, has its source in God's covenant of grace. I quote, "All the benefits that Christ acquired and distributes to his church are benefits of the covenant of grace. This covenant has its foundation in eternity. It is grounded in God's electing love. End of quote. Because I have demonstrated Bavink's teaching that the covenant is rooted in election, in the recent book, Covenant and Election in the Reformed Tradition, I need say no more about this essential aspect of the truth of salvation by sovereign grace in Bavink, and I want to address that further in my second speech this morning. I call attention briefly to one other strength of Bavink's dogmatics, and that is his development of the truth of predestination, particularly with regard to the old brotherly debate between supralapsarians and infralapsarians. Bavink performs some worthwhile development of dogma in that connection, and I merely call attention to that at this time. But I must conclude by pointing out two main weaknesses in Bavink's Reformed dogmatics. I say nothing about the weakness of his doctrine of common grace because my colleague will treat that this afternoon. But the first of the two errors I want to call attention to is Bavink's theological conviction that there is something good, something true, in virtually all the philosophies, all the scientific theories, and all of the cultural works of ungodly men and women. Even though these philosophies and teachings are avowedly anti-Christian and unbelieving, Bavink thought he could find something good in them, and also that he should accommodate Reformed theology to those anti-Christian philosophies and teachings. Bavink could never absolutely and sharply condemn ungodly philosophies and teachings, whether they were the teachings of Friedrich Schleiermacher or the teachings of Charles Darwin. On two occasions, Abraham Kuyper, Bavink's colleague, criticized Bavink publicly for finding good things to say about gross heretics. Kuyper was more antithetical in that regard than was Herman Bavink. Kuyper wrote publicly, "You must condemn these men and their teachings because they are evil and they are influencing the Reformed congregations and people." And this criticism irritated Bavink sorely. This weakness on Bavink's part was due not only to his doctrine of common grace, but also to Bavink's conviction that theology must find in some ungodly philosophy a kind of basis and guide for itself, must take this worldly thinking into account, and must try to find a point of contact with the thinking of the ungodly world. I only point out one instance of this with its disastrous effects, and that is Bavink's accommodation of his teaching about creation to the evolutionary theory of Charles Darwin. Bavink allows Darwin evolutionary theory to influence his explanation of the opening chapters of the Bible. And this bore bitter fruit in Bavink's own lifetime. One of his students, one of his disciples, a man named Natelenbos, while Bavink was still alive, denied the historicity of the opening chapters of the Bible, the first 11 chapters of Genesis, denied that anything in those chapters was historical, and also with it denied that the Bible was infallibly inspired. The churches condemned Natelenbos for that doctrine, nor did Bavink rise to his defense, but Natelenbos claimed to be advocating what he had been taught by Bavink. And then a few years after Bavink died, another of his students, another minister in the Reformed churches in the Netherlands, a more well-known name, Geelkerken, also denied the historicity of the opening chapters of the Bible, denied that there ever was a speaking serpent, and Geelkerken, too, appealed to Bavink, his dogmatics professor, in support of this compromise, in fact, denial of the biblical account of creation, and therewith the Bible's own claim to be the inspired, trustworthy, and infallible Word of God. And that's the second error that I want to recognize in the dogmatics of Bavink. His doubt concerning Scripture came out in his explanation of the doctrine of Scripture. At the crucial point in the Reformed dogmatics, when he is explaining what Scripture is, Bavink wrote this: Scripture is totally the product of the Spirit of God, and at the same time, totally the product of the activity of the authors. Everything in Scripture is divine, and everything is human. That's fatal to the doctrine of Scripture and ultimately to the Christian faith, which is, of course, the Reformed faith. If the Bible is wholly human as well as wholly divine, then it is the word of man as much as it is the word of God. It can be criticized. It can be denied. It can be subjected to the contrary thinking of the wise of this world. It's a noteworthy thing that in the Reformed confessions, never is the Bible referred to as human. Always it is described as divine. These are two prominent serious errors. And the development of Reformed theology that takes the dogmatics of Bavink into account, as it should, must purge the dogmatics of those two errors. The calling, therefore, in my judgment, of the Protestant Reformed churches and of their ministers regarding the Reformed dogmatics of Bavink is, first of all, that negatively we continue to reject and resist with might and main the dung that is found in the gold of the Reformed dogmatics. But then at the same time, in my judgment, our calling is to carry on the tradition of the glories of the Reformed faith that are, in fact, confessed and developed in the Reformed dogmatics of Bavink, and particularly the teachings in the Reformed dogmatics concerning salvation by sovereign grace, and not excluding salvation in the covenant of grace. I thank you for your patient attention.